You know, Keith, it's always embarrassing when we're Eddie and I are talking about before we go on air how cool we think you are before we talk to you, and I didn't know you could hear us. Could you hear that whole conversation?
Not the whole conversation.
Good. Never mind then. You're just a normal guy. We're just normal guys hanging out. Yeah. Okay. How are you?
I'm good. Yep. Well, that's a relative question. I'm good. How are you?
Same. You know, good considering. Yeah. It's good to talk to you here. I got some stuff to ask you about. I was looking back because I guess for a bit you had went back to Australia. And I'm not sure what was happening over there, but while you were there, I was thinking, does he get recognized more while he's in Australia or in America when he's out? Like, where are you a bigger deal?
Where am I a bigger deal? I get recognized. Both places the same.
It's the same, Bobby.
I'm trying to milk a turnip here. I'm not getting anything from this question.
He's equally as famous.
He's
in
just
both
super
places.
Famous everywhere. What the crap, man?
Do you ever have it to where somebody comes up to, you know, your wife and says something to her, and they just completely don't even pay attention to you?
No. I mean, people are just honestly, people are nice in general. I mean.
Yeah,
that's been our experience, honestly.
They're both just so famous. What's it like to be Keith Urban? To wake up and just know, one, you're super good looking, you smell great, you're talented, you have a great wife.
Yeah, because you can smell me right now, right, Bundy?
Keith, we've told you about the smell.
2020 is just a waste of good cologne.
Well, you were voted best smelling country artist of 2020. I mean, I was the only one who voted, but congratulations. There it is.
Okay. Thank you. That's better than the alternative. I appreciate that.
I do want to talk about music for a second. Keith Urban's on. The Speed of Now Part 1 is out. It was released last Friday. It's your 10th record. I was watching that duet at the ACMs with Pink, and I got to tell you, of all the virtual performances I've seen, of all of them, this one was so legit. It looked like you guys were in the same spot. Like, who had the idea for that concept of you guys to be on that screen with, like, the electricity in the middle?
Ben Dalgleish, who's my sort of creative designer partner. We work together on most things that I do. He's got a great team, and what he's really good at is simple concepts. His idea was also for the Global Citizen performance, where there was three of me. Doing the split screen with Pink was his idea. It's very, very simple, but I think it comes off quite effective.
How do you go and approach an artist like Pink with the song? Because you have this song, One Too Many, and I'm assuming you wrote it thinking she'd be perfect for it, but how does that process play out?
Yeah, it was written as a duet, and I just love her voice. I've always loved her voice. I love her humanity that I always feel when she sings. It's like a lot of people have got great voices, but she has this incredibly strong humanity in her voice that I've always felt. So she's a great storyteller as well as a great vocalist. And so through a mutual sort of acquaintance, I got the song to her and was just ecstatic when I got to hear her vocal on it. Because, I mean, we had to do it remotely. She recorded her vocals in California. I was in Nashville. But the day that I was in my studio and hit play and heard her voice on it for the first time was just amazing.
Have you ever, and I'm not going to ask you to name anyone, sent one off to someone and they go, you know what? Nah, not for me, Keith Urban.
Yeah. Oh, but a lot of the time it's because of, it's either the song's not quite right, or what happens sometimes is they got a song coming out at the exact same time and they're like, I can't, the timing's off. Can you wait a while to put this song out? And sometimes you can, sometimes you can't. So, compatibility is everything, you know. It's a terrible feeling though when you send a song to someone and they're like, you got anything else?
I'm going to play a clip of that one before I get on to some of these other songs. Here is One Too Many, okay. The duet with Pink. Here's a clip. I spent all my money drinking on my own, yeah. In this bar, just sat here staring at my phone. When you listen to your music, and let's say you finish a record, you're super pumped that it's going to get out to the public. will you sit and just blare it and listen to it before you finally clear it and go, yep, this is it? Or do you just kind of hear it and go, I know it's good? Like, do you have your moments where you jack the volume up and just let it rip?
Oh, all the above. Actually, I think turning the volume down incredibly low where you can barely hear it is more effective, because so many songs I discover that way. You know, you're in the car driving, the radio's on or something, and it's down low because you're all chatting. And then you hear something, you're like, what's that? And you turn it up. So for me, it's got to grab you super, super quiet. And then there's people I play songs for, like you, Bobby, that come to my house and listen to some songs, and I get not only feedback, but I like I love playing songs for people because I like to gauge their reaction, but also my own. Like, do I feel good playing you this song or do I not? You know, and so let me just say I appreciate you coming over to the studio that day to hear a bunch of these songs before everybody else did.
You know, I've only ever done that with you and a couple of times, because I just don't go listen to new music for people before it comes out. But because you're my guy, I've been over to the house twice. And I tell you what I like about, because sometimes these radio people will come in, they'll be like, let me play you a song in the room here at the station. And I'm like, no, because how do you act? You have to like bounce your head while you're listening. Like you have to somehow. But what you do that's super nice is you turn your back to me and you don't watch me listen. And because it's so awkward, even if you love it, to have someone watch you while you listen to a song.
Oh, yeah. No, I'd almost prefer to leave the room. Because it is. It's intimidating for you and it's awkward for me. And I'm like, just listen to the song. But still, like, I don't even have to be in the room. But if I'm sitting outside and I can hear it and I know you're listening to it, I still gauge, do I feel good about this song, knowing that you're in there listening to it or somebody's in there listening to it. That's really important to me. If I feel good about that, then I'm good. I'm good with it.
I'm going to play a clip here of Tumbleweed. I really like this song, so I'm going to play it for my listeners now. Here is some of Keith Urban, Tumbleweed. So with a song like this that's just so fast, do you ever write a song like this or record a song and go, you know what, maybe we should make it faster, or maybe you have a song and you make it slower than you've originally written it? I just wonder, did this song start this fast?
This song did start this fast. There's a track on the record called Superman that when it was about to get released, I was like, man, I feel like it should be just at like two beats faster in tempo. And of course, with technology, you can do it without speeding up the singer. Back in the day, of course, you'd speed up the tape and the singer would speed up, but you can pick up the tempo and keep the key change, keep key the same. This is a weird story. So we sped it up. I thought, sounds great. Fantastic. Right. And then we had to do it properly with the mixing and the whole thing and everything. And we sent it out. I didn't listen to it before it went out. It's very, very rare of me to do this. It comes out. I listen to it and it gets to the guitar solo. And I was like, the guitar solo sounds like it's like out of time. What the heck? I listened to it a bunch of times. I'm like, the guitar solo is slow. It's dragging. What the heck? We get in there and figure out every part of the track has been picked up two beats faster, except the guitar solo, which accidentally got left at the old tempo. So the solo starts perfect, and as it goes on, it gets a little slower and a little slower. And it was a terrible feeling, but we fixed it finally. We had to get it. We had to figure out how to do that. But every now and then, things go awry.
Here is
when you're changing tempos of songs.
I'll keep that note. Here's a little bit of Superman from Keith Urban. Keith, would you ever go back to being a judge on a singing competition?
I'd be open to it, because I enjoyed doing Idol. It was good. I enjoyed doing The Voice when I did that in Australia originally. I'd be open to it. I like the mentoring side of it probably more than anything, being able to genuinely try and give advice that can be helpful more than anything else.
How lucky would they be if it was Keith Urban? Like, that's what I do on American Idol. Mm-hmm. I'm the full-time mentor. but I don't know crap. Keith's talking about BPMs for guitar solos, and I'm like, do a thong that sounds good. There's a big difference in our mentoring styles, I think.
You need all your, you need everything, though. You need all skill sets, for sure.
I saw on your Instagram that you've been married 14 years. You posted back early summer. What do you find for you is the key to a successful long-term marriage?
Well, I don't know about anybody's but my own. Ours has just been, I just treat Nick like she's my girlfriend, right? That's it. So I do everything I did when we started dating. That's it.
It's a pretty good tip, huh?
Yeah, it's really good.
You have to kind of be reminded probably to do that. I mean, I've been with my girlfriend 10 months now, so now that's still pretty new. But I think that's good. You could put that in your calendar once a month. You should see that and let it remind you to do something. Hey, pretty good advice.
Yeah, he's good.
That's it. That's it. All right. All right, Keith. I think that's it. I think that's everything I wanted to ask you. I'm gonna wrap with this. It's the final question I'm gonna wrap with. If they were to make a Keith Urban Halloween costume, what are the three things they must include to get your look down?
What the? What? Do you stay up late nights trying to carve these in-depth questions, Bobby?
How many times have you ever been asked that question? You do 1,000 interviews.
There's a question generator app in your phone.
I didn't know I was going to get hassled here for... Okay, answer the question here. We got three things that people, they must include to get your look. What is it?
Oh, my gosh. I don't know. Maybe I'm just terrifying enough like this. Here we go. This will be... very, very frightening for all the children on Halloween to get.
Amy, let's do it.
I would say maybe a hair,
a wig
straightener.
Oh,
or like a wig. Yeah, a wig that has straight hair down.
Beautiful straight hair.
Right.
Yes.
Maybe some tattoos.
Nice.
Oh. Like coming out of your shirt neck area and then on your arm, and then.
Yeah.
Oof, cologne, probably.
Or walk around with cologne. I'd say a guitar would probably be the easiest
one. Okay, a guitar for sure.
Thank you, Bobby. A guitar. Wouldn't that be good?
I was wrong. I have one more question.
Oh, yeah.
We read in the news that you have a sky garage in New York where you drive your car into this garage and the garage takes your car to the top level. True or false?
Yeah. False.
What?
What?
No.
We don't have a... Well, half true.
Okay, let's hear some
the
more.
The apartment building that we were in, we're not in there anymore, but what we were in, has a garage in it. I don't think anybody actually uses it, so they all just build out that space. But that's what the building was built with, because there's no parking, so they like had cars go to everybody's floor. It's crazy. I don't think one person uses it.
Oh.
It made it seem like in the news that you had this fancy contraption that you pull your car into.
Like an elevator.
And it takes you right up to basically your bedroom. You get out of the car, and then the car goes and parks somewhere else.
No.
Okay.
Not true.
I will say this. The last time I saw Keith driving, he was driving a big old truck. I was behind this guy in a big old truck, and we were both going to the Opry. I host a show. He was playing the show, and it was the biggest truck. And I was like, I wonder what the profession of this man in this massive truck is, because it was so big. And I drive up, and I'm in my car. He's in his truck. And I look over, and it's freaking Keith in his big truck. That's all. That's my story.
Well, it's big enough so that when your electric car runs out of battery, I can just pop you your whole car in the back.
All right.
And then we'll make it home.
All right. With that, we're going to go. Hey, listen, you know we love you here. Everybody, check out Keith's
record.
I
love you too, Bobby. You too, Amy.
Thank you.
We'll see you soon.
You will.
All right, there he is.
Bye.
Bye, there he is. There's Keith Urban. Dang. That guy. Check out his music, man. It's so good. It's so good. I don't talk about going to his house.
I know, but he brought it up.
He did bring it up. And I'm always a little bit like, I'm not that cool. And Keith and I are buds a little bit outside of the show. We used to live pretty near each other. He's like, hey, come over to the house the first time. And I was like, man, I don't know. And he's like, just come over to the house and I'll play you a few songs. And I'm like, I don't listen to songs. And so I went because I like him, but he never looked at me. And then he asked me again. He said, wait, would you come back over? And it was during COVID. He's like, we don't have to touch. There's Lysol by the door. Come on in, sit down. So I went over and just the best.